Hello everyone, and welcome to the Modern Java course. In this video, we'll discuss a big pain point in Java, understanding the nuances of performance. How can we authoritatively say if X is faster than Y? Before I proceed, as usual, the code for this and the other videos in this series is available on my GitHub page. So check out this project, start it, and follow me on GitHub. The Microbenchmark suite was added as part of the JDK Enhancement Proposal 230. The motivation behind this is rather elaborate. When we want to test if something performs well, we usually just write a simple test that runs in a loop and measures the time it takes. This works for Java, but is very inaccurate. Java programs are usually executed with a JIT compiler. Code that runs in a JIT can start slow and then get recompiled for faster performance as it executes. To make matters even worse, a GC can have an uneven impact on performance that can completely skew test results. These problems led to many falsehoods and mistakes in the world of Java. There was no single unified way to test the performance of a method. Brian Goetz, who is the Java language architect, eloquently described the problem. The scary thing about microbenchmarks is that they always produce a number. Even if that number is meaningless, they measure something. We're just not sure what. To use the microbenchmark framework, we need to configure Maven a bit differently than we normally do. We need to create a Maven archetype based on JMH to include the necessary annotations as shown here. In order to use the microbenchmark suite, we need to first add the dependencies to the POM file as shown here. Otherwise, the annotations and bootstrap code won't work. Next, we can start with the benchmark class. This is a relatively simple Java class. Each benchmark is an instant method with a benchmark annotation indicating its role. The method should have a descriptive name, so we will understand the final report. Notice I make sure to return a result from the benchmark. This is important, otherwise the optimizer might optimize out the code if it decides that it does nothing. Also notice we don't print anything. Logging or similar changes can impact performance and skew the results. There are several ways to run the benchmark, but the simplest is to add a main class. Notice that we don't run the methods directly. We use the runner and provide the relevant options as an argument. The runner does the actual work. Benchmark execution is very slow. At the top, we can see the versions of the JMH and JVM. We can also see all the command line arguments and applicable information. If someone else will run the benchmark, you can easily tell the environmental differences. Here we see the configuration of the benchmark. How every stage looks. We first have a warm-up stage to neutralize the impact of the JIT. We then run 5 iterations of measurements to eliminate variance. We have timeouts and a single thread. Here we can see the output of the warm-up stage. These aren't interesting for most cases, but we might want to look for anomalies here to see if there's something significant. This is the result of the first test for list performance. This is the warm-up for the second benchmark, and the result for the second benchmark. Finally, in the end, we get both results together and can see the throughput of the array is faster than the list, but not at the scale it was 10 years ago. Newer JDKs and JITs made the difference much smaller. The Microbenchmark is an amazing educational tool. We often assume things about JDK performance and don't spend the time verifying them. To be clear, you shouldn't code to a benchmark. You should write correct code. But if you do code to a benchmark, you should at least make sure that the benchmark is well written. In the next video, we will discuss Project Loom and virtual threads. Follow through the videos to check out the full course. If you have any questions, please use the comments section. Thank you.